is mostly for you after this lecture to know only two things. We will start with the introduction to the synthetic aperture radar basic principle. We will focus, it's a good term, on the first aspect, which is to achieve a fine resolution in the distance, that means in the range, in the line of sight of the radar. Then we will recall the major principle, which is the phase history of the target. This will help us to produce the fine azimuth along track resolution. I will, after that, try to describe what is an unfocused star, then a focused star, and as I said, we will do some ocean application. And it's a little bit technical, and if you don't understand at all, please interrupt. And if you understand, okay, so that's perfect. You tell me at the end. Not so sure. You want to translate or not?
Yeah, I think it's okay because.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So everybody, that's perfect.
Yeah.
And if some details are needed, you will make the.
Yes. Sure.
Here is just the picture of the famous European spaceborne Envisat, which lasts for 10 years. And this was equivalent to send a bus in space. That means that you had to send this big platform full of instruments carrying measurement for the atmosphere as well as for the ocean. And this instrument cost billions, in fact 8 billion euro, which is enormous, and it was a dream for an engineer and a bit of nightmare I guess also to put all this instrument. And the king of the instrument on this platform was the advanced synthetic aperture radar, and this picture shows that this antenna, this ESA antenna, is 8 meters large. This SAR means synthetic aperture radar, and we will understand why it's called synthetic. And but basically, this is simply an active instrument to transmit and receive the electromagnetic wave radiation, try to store the data in amplitude and phase, and as detected by the instrument. And as we recall, this instrument usually works in the presence of clouds, day and night, operates at microwave on radar frequencies. We'll come back on this. And most important is that synthetic aperture radar has been seen as the most performant and quite fascinating solution to obtain fine resolution independent on the platform height, and with an image with the same resolution on the order of 10 meters, we will see how to achieve such a high resolution. And that can be obtained either from satellite or from airplane. And basically, as we will see, it's more easier to obtain this and to achieve this very fine resolution from satellite than from airplane. Okay. So, main principle, and for you to get, is that we will have what we say the and to set up the geometry, we are talking of the range direction when it's in the line of sight of the instrument, and we will talk on the azimuth direction where it's along the trajectory of the satellite. So range, azimuth, that's the term that are used all along the lecture. The swath that can be achieved is generally constrained by the range in the range direction, and the swath for will be between the near range, which corresponds to the first incidence angle, and the far range, which corresponds to the largest incidence angle that the instrument can achieve. The slant range direction is in fact directly in line of sight of the instrument without any projection on the ground. And here you see that basically the SAR instrument are generally near polar orbiting instrument, altitude from 600 to 800 kilometers. We can come back on this because the Russians were very famous to launch SAR in the 80s before the European. And the satellite at that time from the Russian, they were launched at a very low altitude. And the Almaz series of SAR were flying, I think, at 250 or 300 kilometers. So this is quite bad for the drag of the mission along the orbit. And so meaning that the lifetime of the spacecraft is limited, or that you need to have fuel in order to keep the orbit. But at the same time, it's very interesting to have a low, to fly at a low altitude for some reasons that I will try to explain at the end. As we saw, the antenna size is of the order of 10 by 1 meter. 1 meter will be 10 meters the width and 1 meter the height. The 1 meter will help to achieve between near range and far range. And if for 1 meter approximately, you can sweep from 20 degrees up to 50 degrees, or here 15 to 60 degrees in incidence angle. So this is just to recall what I just said. The incidence angle is what we call the elevation angle here. This is related to the normal to the Earth surface. You have the Earth is not flat. This is not helping us because we have to correct for this local geometry. But basically, this is to have the geometry in mind. So again, this is to illustrate how the instrument will make an image. In this case, the instrument is flying toward the left, and the image will be built as function of time as we go from right to left. And the swath here will be all the illuminated area, and this will be constructed by the, and we will see how to achieve this. And immediately you can form a two-dimensional image at very high resolution along the track of the instrument. So this is not really true, as the instrument is very needs to have heavy processing. In fact, there is very few instruments in space today that can perform in real time all this image. And so usually what happens is that you store the information along the orbit, and you transmit the information when you are in front of a receiving station. There exist for military and for airborne, they have real-time processor on board, so like that they can receive the information in real-time as it is expressed here. Okay, so again on the principle, we will the instrument is emitting very short microsecond very high energy pulses, and we are trying to measure the in time the returning echoes that are deformed by the ocean surface or by the ice or by the ground. And what we will do from this, and as discussed by Vladimir Kudryavtsev from the preceding lecture, is the relative strength of the returning echoes compared to the emitted echoes. So that's the magnitude or the attenuation. In general, you receive less than you emit. Then, obviously, you will need to follow the phase, and you will try to have a chronology of what you send and what you receive very very precisely in order to associate exactly one pulse with one one point. Then you will use different polarization and you can play with the Doppler frequency. The same antenna is used for transmission and reception, so you will emit and you will listen with some I don't know how you say that, so like type of signal, and but you can also use different antenna, different for emission and transmission. Okay, this is just to for you to have the word. I don't think that you will need all this, but if you one day you have a talk on a SAR or someone, they will often use the term coherent. That means the SAR principle is to try to consider the that there is, that there is very very little randomness in the signal, and that you can record the echoes coherently, that you don't lose the phase, and that in fact you can indeed follow the information along the time. And so accordingly, if you want to follow very precisely this echoes, you need to have a detection at very high sampling rate. What I just say and repeat, in fact, is the fact that if you are considering coherent recording, this is mostly to follow the information on the phase of the scatter back to the instrument. And this is very, very important, as you will be able to sum up coherently or to transform or process coherently these signals, as they are very highly sampled in time. Okay, so this is the goal, is to achieve fine resolution, and we'll come back to this. Just to recall, we were probably you received this before. We are mostly talking about wavelength microwave active instrument. The wavelength are from Ka to P band. The latest accepted instrument from the European Space Agency is a P band instrument. It's called Biomass, and this P band is used mostly to get information through the canopy. That means that you can look through the trees, and this is why you can they claim that using P-band SAR will allow to investigate the biomass and to evaluate the transformation of the of this, and especially the permafrost in the near Arctic region, for instance. And but for application for ocean, P-band is not generally used. L-band has been used by Japanese. They are able to control L-band, and so they have the technology to do L-band. S-band, there is no instrument in S-band. S-band is 9 cm, L-band 20 cm, and P-band of the order of 1 meter. P-band is going through the ice, through the tree. C-band, for instance, doesn't go through the trees, doesn't penetrate too much in the ice, even not at all, and absolutely not in the ocean. And military are usually using X-band, and you could build Ku-band and Ka-band SAR, but they are not existing so far. Okay, so to we go like that. That's your one. Okay. Oh. It's full. Not mine. Okay. So interestingly, we see that this is to give you what is in fact the exact resolution of the instrument before we do any processing. The instrument is at, say, I don't know exactly the height, but of the order of 700 kilometers. Then the range, according to the incidence, is of the order of 850 kilometers. Then the aperture, the angle of aperture, which is controlled by the ratio between the wavelength of the microwave to the size of the antenna, gives you the resolution that instantaneously the SAR can or the instrument is measuring. So the exact along track resolution before processing for an instrument with L of the order of 10 meters, such as the Handysat, was 8 meters, I think. Whatever. The C band is of the order of 5 centimeters. This is giving you an instantaneous resolution of the order of 4 kilometers. So, in fact, you are not very well resolved when you are using an instrument from space. And indeed, it's very bad, and that's why you have to. We have to think about a process to improve this this type of resolution. 4 kilometers is not good enough. So the I repeat. The azimuth resolution is determined by the angular width of the antenna beam pattern, meaning that the resolution will increase with the distance, with range. This resolution will be controlled mostly by the aperture, the angle of aperture, which is the ratio between the microwave wavelength to the antenna length. And in order to achieve a very fine resolution, it would be necessary either to change, okay, obviously, the wavelength, so considering to divide the wavelength by 2, okay, but this will make still not too good, to reduce the attitude of the instrument, and that's what the Russian did. This is not a bad idea either, so you you improve. Then you put a monster in space of the order of 1 kilometer, and then you are super result. So in fact, the idea is to launch an inflatable antenna that can be 1 kilometer. No, it's a joke. But it's not completely a joke. That they will one day launch satellite with inflatable antenna. Believe me. No, don't say no. It will come. I think it's already in geostationary. They are thinking, you imagine, this, when you are at a distance that allow you to be geostationary, that means that you are at the distance of the order of 30,000 kilometers. So in fact, you see the whole hemisphere at once. But you want to achieve a nice resolution. In fact, they decided to try to promote some indeed inflatable. And so they deploy enormous antenna. But this is not yet for this type of application. It will come. I'm sure it will come. But maybe not 1 kilometer. Okay. So we will see. So what we need, in fact, is to synthesize this very, very large and wide antenna by considering that a larger antenna is made as the superposition of small antenna. So it's equivalent to consider this large, large, large antenna from the fact that if you could associate n times this the initial length of the radar antenna. Okay, so this is what people were thinking. So it's artificial, meaning that it will need some processing. That indeed, as the instrument is moving, the antenna, if we are able to know where the signal is, we'll be able, normally, to observe and synthesize this large antenna. And we will go back to this to try to make a little mathematic application. But this is, as we will see at the end, nothing depends upon the wavelength of the instrument. Nothing depends upon the height of the instrument, the incidence angle, nothing. You don't care. The only thing that you can achieve is that it's controlled by the length of the instrument. So it's magical. Okay. You don't think it's magical? Tell me. It's my life. I made my life on SAR. Believe me, 20 years to work on this stupid instrument. And so I have to love it. You know, it's you know, when you at some point, no divorce. So I still enjoy to talk about it. And this is really magical. I think that you imagine that at first you start with something which is completely depending upon the wavelength, the distance, the incidence angle, whatever. But send 1 meter antenna in space would be much better than the 10 meter antenna. And the 1 meter antenna will provide you 50 centimeter resolution on ground. Just like that. Smaller, better this time. Okay, so this is really beautiful. I think it has been obtained, I don't know, say that the, I don't really remember the name of the guy who did this first, but I think he was American, and I don't know how he found it, really, by chance, I guess. Whatever. So I repeat what's going on. And we will discuss a little bit about the range, not the azimuth. We'll come back to the azimuth after. So azimuth is along track the instrument. when the instrument is flying along track. The across track is the range direction, and this is the initial resolution that you have in your your field of view with your instrument, meaning that you have the whole swath could be a few hundred kilometers, and you, as you we obtain, we are here of the order of 4 kilometers, meaning that when we receive the signal, this beautiful signal as function of time, we are in fact measuring everything that goes inside this across swath information, without knowledge of exactly what's going on at this point, for instance, or this point. And this is the principle. So, in order to achieve the this is from German side that we will recommend if you want to play after. So this is just to recall that it's the main principle comes from the fact that as function of time you can a given point will follow a distance.
Not me.
I know. So I have to be faster. Okay. So here you make the approximation of the phase. Okay, so the distance. That's clear? Okay, and we jump. Okay. So in fact, the distance can be recorded according to this equation. Given some center or whatever, this is the velocity of the spacecraft as function of time. Y is in the azimuth. Okay, there is no reason that the satellite will die, so there is no change in altitude. So from a given distance at some origin, we have the rate of change of this distance as function of time, and the rate of this distance as function of time will induce a change in the phase of the signal that you are trying to record. And from the phase of the signal, once you derive the phase of the signal, this is going in the phase, this is in fact translating the change of the phase that could correspond to a change in so-called Doppler frequency. So basically, we know that if we follow the phase of the signal we receive back, we should obtain the a change of frequency that is completely related to the velocity of the spacecraft. So the Doppler, as any Doppler phenomena, will change the will make the frequency to change as function of time according to this rule. So you will, in fact, you are artificially using the phase history to find the best Doppler that can match your target at a given point and given distance from the antenna. Is it clear? I know it's not. I don't touch anything. Okay. So whatever. So this is not clear, I understand. So, but we repeat and repeat again and repeat again. So the Doppler effect is a major source of information you can get from the phase history of the point target. That means that when you receive your signal, you can follow, or you know that the phase that goes into your signal, your cosine and sine, will have an evolution in square root in power 2 of the time. This constant is only driven by the velocity, the knowledge of the velocity of the spacecraft, knowledge of the wavelength, and knowledge of the mean distance. And this, you normally you know everything about this information. So, as your phase is evolving quadratically, you expect to have a so-called Doppler effect that will be linear in time. So your signal, as you will be able to have the same effect if you listen to the train coming. I don't know when someone explained to you Doppler. Did you try to explain Doppler? Do you have kids? Not yet. So Doppler is known. Okay. So I always have trouble with my kid, but that's okay. So in any case, as the motion is coming, you sweep with higher tone. That means the frequency is increasing with time. And so once you understand this Doppler effect, you can try to see what could be the effect on your possibility to process the signal to achieve a better resolution. So, as we have the beam as a maximum centered at a given point, as the maximum illumination time of the point target is defined, we will be able to refine exactly the length of the synthetic aperture to match exactly this effect of the change of the Doppler between the minimum and the maximum. So we understand that once you have this change, you allow of the change of the frequency, inverse of this frequency is in fact the maximum time you can integrate, or vice versa, if you have a time to integrate over the surface, you will define exactly the resolution in Doppler you can achieve. And this, as we can, I can make it if you want, or I can ask someone to do the math. We can, maybe you want. Igor, yes? No.
No.
No? Okay. So, whatever. So, at the end, believe me, you can achieve the maximum resolution that has nothing to do with the instrument wavelength, and this is only driven by the length of the antenna. We will come back to this later, I hope. I don't know what you did with my presentation. It was a beautiful presentation. Okay. Unfocused. Okay, so we jump to unfocused. But you want to make the, no, you don't want to make the demonstration for me. For everybody. Yes.
What do you mean?
To achieve the resolution. Yes or no? No, no need. Just for fun. So I repeat. So like that. It will be recorded now. I see it's recorded, so very important. So the total the initial resolution is given by the ratio, is mostly driven by the ratio of the length of the antenna to the wavelength of the of the microwave radiation. So this is given. It takes, for instance, some time to achieve 40 kilometers. We must keep in mind that an instrument at 800 kilometers is traveling at 7 kilometers per second. Roughly, it takes 0.5 seconds to sweep completely over the this initial resolution. But once you set up this time, this total time will allow you, in fact, and will allow you to achieve what the phase of a point can change. That means that your Doppler is fixed by the time it takes for the antenna to travel through the initial resolution. I think it's clear. Then, it's, as we understand, this doesn't depend anymore on the on anything else than the length of the original instrument. Shorter the initial length of the antenna, it's indeed better to sample the full sweep of the initial resolution, and that's why you achieve finer resolution, because you have a finer Doppler, and so on. Okay, if it's, again, if it's not clear, I can make it here, if you want, just to have fun, or you, or if you don't care, just remind that the resolution for that you can achieve following the this can be maximal at and given by the length over two of the antenna. But before this, if you are really someone that is lazy, you can consider that you can do a good job without doing much and without doing any, in fact, mathematical transformation. And this is called unfocused star. And in fact, in this case, the processing will be to achieve a much finer resolution compared to the initial resolution, but without a very elaborated signal processing. And this simplified technique is just to follow the phase as long as the phase doesn't go too fast and doesn't turn more than a given value. As you understand, the phase history around t is quadratic in time. So as long as the time is very short, t squared is very small, and the phase change is certainly very, very small. And so if you concentrate on just making the average of the signal by a box within, say, few samples, where in fact the phase didn't change, this is fairly decent approximation of the zero phase, and then you can achieve already a good resolution. And as expressed here, since the addition is very simple for an operational instrument, image formation can be real time, and it's could give already some quick and dirty image formation. So this is just to exemplify. This is, so we recall the amplitude is a cosine the for the real part and the sine in the imaginary part, and we can consider that within, say, 20 samples, the phase didn't change much, and that just taking this 20 sample will provide some, will help to achieve a certain resolution, which corresponds to the inverse not the inverse, this is the act. So, which will be generally linearly proportional to the width of this signal. And so the phase history is in fact when the time starts to be stupidly large, and that you have all this oscillation, and that's why you cannot achieve by this simple average you cannot resolve this part of the signal. But in this part of the signal, they add very well. In the other part, they are discarded. And so, in fact, you see that you already can give quite good estimate by this very simple coherent average of, here it's 20 samples. I think the next one will be, for instance, 38 samples. Whatever that means, it's just like it's to provide you some idea that you need only very few samples to add, and this will help you to achieve a much finer resolution. The resolution you can achieve in this case is related to the change in phase, and you can consider that following the phase history, and you recall that this is square, so that's why you will see that if you want a certain proportion with pi, say that you don't want the phase to turn more than 45 degrees, that's pi over 4, this, you equalize these two phases, then you obtain exactly the resolution that in this case will be obtained as function of the product of the distance and the wavelength. So this is not perfect. It still depends upon the distance and the wavelength. But if we make a numerical application, and I think Igor will make it, 800 kilometers, 5 centimeters, this is giving you
4 kilometers.
No.
No. Yeah, we calculate.
No. This one. 800 kilometers, 5 centimeters.
Yes.
This is giving me here.
Yeah, it's 40, then you should decrease it by 2. 40 in 10, so.
So this is 150 meters.
Yeah.
Okay, so the resolution you can achieve by being completely stupid is to meaning that you can provide this information quite rapidly is 150 meters instantaneously. So you obtain very easily information at some 150 meters. We will see that we go at 10 meters, but already it's not too bad. You start from 4 kilometers and you go to 150 meters. If you take a Ku band rather than a C band, it will be 100 meters. And the next generation will consider probably Ka band. Ka band is 0.8 centimeters, and this will give you immediately 75 meter resolution. And this is just an example when you equate according to an aperture of the order of 45 degrees, meaning pi over 4. Okay, so now we go to a more, if we want to do the complete focusing, and then to achieve the full potential of the SAR, and to obtain the resolution we would like to have, we need to, in fact, match exactly the change of the phase as function of time with a filter that will exactly compensate this change of the phase. And this is by so-called matching filter technique. And this is the standard way to process synthetic aperture measurement. So this match filter process is quite easy to perform. We didn't discuss here the range resolution. Where is the range resolution? After?
It was before.
Before.
Yes.
And we missed it.
Yeah, I think that it's no, something with the system.
It. Okay.
Some slides you have already passed. They were in the beginning.
Ah, they were at the beginning.
Yes.
Okay. So that's my fault. Okay. So whatever. So it's just to go back. What would be the technique to recognize that you have the range, the right range as function of time? The in order to achieve the resolution in range, it's mostly due to the fact that you expect, as according to the delay it takes to go from the instrument to the ground, ground to the instrument, divided by the speed of light. This is what you expect from a range resolution. But this is very, very difficult. First, you would need to have a perfect clock. So in order to achieve the range resolution, in fact, and following the idea that we have for the azimuth, in fact, the engineer thought that, okay, we should also consider to send a chirp, that means a linearly evolving frequency. So it's not a perfect C band that you that you send. It's a chirp, that means centered around the C band that you choose. You slightly modulate this frequency to in fact measure as function of time the exact frequency that is given back to you. So in fact you impose in this case that the signal you emit has a change of phase due to what you sent. So this is the first tracking.